I'm Kevin Devine and I meet stars and celebrities right here on the streets of London and have great chats with them, like this. Now normally I need to introduce myself to people. Fred McCauley, how are you doing?
Needs no introduction at all.
Absolutely not.
How are you?
I'm very good. Now, good. I see travel bags.
Yes.
You're in the streets of London.
Uh-huh.
What's a Scotsman like you doing down here today?
This is my life, Kevin. I was down doing a gig last night. I do a lot of corporate stuff, as you know.
Yeah.
So last night I had an award ceremony to present. And I've got another one tomorrow night.
Yeah.
So today I'm just going over to stay with a pal of mine. So I'm just going to go deposit this at the house. And then this is what I do. Over there, they don't know me in any other format other than this. Me with my... It's usually a dinner suit.
Yes.
Sometimes the kilt.
Have you got the kilt in
there? I've not got the kilt in there,
no.
Or else I would have dressed up for you.
Oh, no, I wouldn't expect that. This is like the Batman outfit where you dive into phone boxes and come
That's
out
it.
Suited and booted.
That was Superman.
Well, yes, you're absolutely right.
I hate to correct you,
my
but you know what
wrong.
I'm like. I'm a wee bit touchy about that kind of thing.
And Western House, have you been doing a show from there today?
I have, yeah. There's a suite of studios in Western House, four of them, just little self-op things about yay by yay. And we have one for my morning radio show.
Yeah.
So whenever I'm in London, I go in there and I do my broadcast from there.
Because Macaulay and Co now, is it 11th, 12th year we're in the...
We are just coming to the end of our 15th year.
15th year?
Aye, about to start our 16th.
That's an incredible run.
It is.
An incredible run.
Yep, and I can remember, Kevin, I mean, I've known you probably all of that time. The woman that ran Radio Scotland at the time said, we'd like you to do it for maybe 3, maybe 5 years. Nobody's ever managed to do 5 years. We'd like you to do that and bridge the millennium. And I said, fair enough, we'll see how it goes. And here we are.
Yeah. And it's actually been quite a phenomenal run because it's one of the most listened to shows in Scotland, you
mm-hmm.
know, over that period as well.
Yep.
And you've had loads and loads of great guests. And are there still people out there that you think, come on, I want
Gotta
them
get
on.
Them.
Who's that? Who's...
Do you know this? Probably not. You know, I mean, I've been dead lucky. You know, I've interviewed all of the surviving Monty Python team individually over the years.
Good.
John Cleese a few times. You know, and people that I did gigs with when I was doing stand-up that have gone on to, you know, huge success. Eddie Izzard is a regular. You know, I don't think there's anybody really that I would like to interview. And the nature of the show is that I'm not kind of looking for the Prime Minister or the First Minister or anything like that to come on. Although, you know, Scotland being the small place that it is, Alex Salmond, our First Minister, right? Alex used to be our betting consultant on the show. About 12 years ago, he was our tipster. You know, every Friday we'd phone up Alex Salmond's here now. What we're looking at, we're looking at the 3:30 at Cheltenham, Fred. Go for broke.
Well, he always could pick donkeys in his time, couldn't he? That's the thing.
Yeah.
And talking about your stand-up, Fred, because that's really your bread.
It's still my thing.
Yeah. And you love that.
I still love it, Kevin, yeah.
And because when you started out, there were maybe 4 or 5 Scottish comics.
Yeah.
And now it's a whole different world. But you mentioned you were gigging last night.
Yes.
Do you still get a kick?
Absolutely. I mean, I know this will go up onto the web and it'll sit there forevermore. I mean, it's March 2012.
Yeah.
I'm doing a tour, England and Wales, in the autumn, October, November.
Fantastic.
Just getting out and not filling, but we'll see how it goes, but doing the theatres, right? Because, I mean, it is my first love. And I'll tell you why I did the radio show. It was because I'd been on the road for about 5 years. Ian, our youngest, he hated me. You know, he would see me getting the bags together. They weren't quite as nice as these. Slinging a bag over my shoulder. And he used to latch onto my leg. And I had to drag myself out of the house. And I hated it.
Yeah.
And he hated me being away so much. Because, you know, to do stand-up, even though there were clubs in Scotland, you're doing maybe about 15 nights a month down here. So I gave that up so that I could be at home with the family. But now they're all at university, so I can clear off. And
you can do what you want.
I was just about to say the B word there. But no, so I can get back and do more stand-up, you know.
Because I know, I mean, we've caught you in London today, but you used to be in London a lot.
Yeah.
Because when you were doing the things, you have worked with one of the most iconic shows, Have I Got News For You?
Aye.
And I know you started out doing the warm-up there.
You're absolutely right, yeah. That was way back in the early 90s. It was about Series 3. And I did 4 series way back in the early days.
Yeah.
So it'd be about 92, 93. I got my first spot in it in 95.
How did that feel? Because obviously you were behind the camera.
Yeah.
And you're, you know, the warm-up man, you get them going, and then everyone else comes out, the stars come out, and they got all the big laughs and all that sort of thing. So when you were finally the other side of the camera, what was it like working with Paul and Ian?
It was great. And I'll tell you, I had learned an important lesson, which was that I'd seen a lot of people that I'd worked with come on the show, and, you know, they're dead excited and they're nervous as well. And they'd maybe get their first line out, and if it didn't quite hit the mark, you could see them retreating into themselves. So I knew that just take your time. If the first line doesn't work, don't get upset, keep smiling, get the second one out and the third, and eventually they've got a great editing policy there. They're not going to broadcast the lines that don't work. So that was an advantage, but I mean, it was hugely exciting, you know.
And in the run-up to that, you obviously, you had a wee sneak preview behind and you knew how the whole process worked, like you've said, but were there times where you were guided towards certain bits of topics, or, you know, we're going to be talking about this or that?
Absolutely, it's no secret.
Yeah.
I mean, Have I Got News For You is, it's not the one where you get least warning.
Yeah.
I'll tell you about that in a wee second. But you go in and, I mean, it's 2 years since I've done one, but you go in and they give you a run through at about 5:30,
sure,
just to kind of show you this is maybe what's going to come up. They don't give you everything.
Yeah.
You get maybe some of the headlines that you with the blanks, and then you go away. But you've only, I swear, you've got less than about half an hour to prep stuff. Then you've got supper, then you've got makeup, wardrobe, blah, 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 and you're in, okay? Yeah. So a lot of it is on the hoof. The one where you get absolutely nothing is QI. And I've only done that a couple of times.
Wow.
And they will give you nothing, right?
So you have to be.
You have to be on the ball. And it's just chat. It's just like sitting about with your pals.
Yeah.
And the one where you need to do most is Mock the Week. I mean, Mock the Week is a tough gig. You know, you're prepping for that for days in advance. You know, so all these ones where people step down, you know, and give the individual wee lines, things you wouldn't hear in the lift, that kind of stuff. You've been working on that for a few days. And these are no secrets. I'm not giving anything away.
I think that's...
We rehearsed this. Apart from that line, that was an ad-lib.
Absolutely.
What a great ad-lib that would be. We rehearsed this.
But we didn't.
But we didn't.
See, talking about the... I mean, you've got a career now, 20-odd years and things in the stand-up. So you've got to the stage now, you're on all these big shows. Do you ever still get that sort of fluttery feeling
Absolutely.
When you go out?
Absolutely. Every time, Kevin. I get the fluttery feeling whenever I open the mics for the radio show, and I've been doing it 15 years.
Wow.
And I've always said that. You need it. You need you need that adrenaline rush.
And it's a horrible question to ask, but you're not at the stage now where you've ever gone out in a gig and they just sit there and go...
It happens to everybody.
Even at this...
Oh, God, yeah. Hasn't happened like that for a wee while, but, I mean, I did... And do you know what's nice is interviewing other comics. Just last year, Stuart Lee, who's the American comic, Reginald D. Hunter, they came in and I said, how's it going? You know, Edinburgh Fringe. And they're going, last night was a turkey. Last night, you know, I couldn't say anything funny and I was sweating and all that kind of stuff. But I mean, my worst was a few years ago, a charity gig up at Glen Eagles Hotel.
Right.
Tough room. And you know, I could make a list of excuses, but I got nothing, right? Nothing, Kevin. Hit them with the big lines. You think, I'm going to get a titter. Nothing, right? And there was a host of sporting celebrities there. Bobby Charlton was there.
Yeah.
There was various cricketers, Gareth Edwards, some brilliant rugby players. Nigel Mansell was there. And I'll tell you how badly I was doing that night. It got so quiet, at one point, Nigel Mansell woke up. He woke up to see what the silence was all about.
Oh, God.
And you know what it's like? The salivary glands go.
You dry up.
Everything dries up except your forehead, which just pees sweat.
And have you got, because you're sort of one of the nicer guys in comedy. You've never had a reputation. No, do you know what I mean? You've never had a reputation for saying offensive things or whatever. It's all well-observed material.
Uh-huh.
And you see all this wave of comics coming out now, and who do you sit back and think, I really like them, that's clever, that's good?
Oh, that's a great question. I still admire the people that clearly are thinking on their feet when they're on stage, you know.
Yeah.
I don't think you would categorise him as a stand-up, but Paul Merton is a genius, you know. He is outstanding in our generation of comics, you know, for stuff that he's come up with. Eddie Izzard, the aforementioned, I love the way that he can think of stuff. And then in the same vein, Ross Noble, I mean, Ross, he's so inventive on stage. Then you've got people like Adam Hills, the Aussie comic, a nice, gentle guy, and he, you know, he engages the audience, and I really mean engages with a capital E. I think he has done a marriage ceremony in his shows.
Really? Is it legal?
I don't think
was
so.
Was it legal?
I don't think so. But so I like these Jason Jason Byrne as well. You know, I've seen Jason enough to know that he is doing stuff straight off the top of his head. And you know, I do like well observed stand up. And you know, you mentioned offensiveness, and you know, thinking just about the Scottish comedians, Frankie Boyle. You know, people have had a go at Frankie and said, "Oh, he's offensive." Blah blah blah. Frankie's a gifted comedy writer,
sure.
And he comes up with gags, more gags per day than anybody I know. You know, and I would go and watch him, and you think, well, some of the lines I could never do. I could never say these words, but you've got to admire him for his comedic skill.
I think that's the thing. I started out doing some open spots with Frankie in the Stand Comedy Club, playing to 30 people, and he was always really polished then.
Yeah.
He came out with these great lines, and they were always winners.
Yeah.
You know, and you could see from that early stage, and he just sort of took off from
there.
You know, another comics have been going, God, how can he come up with this and do this sort of thing?
But there is an intangible as well, without getting into the philosophy of comedy, there is an intangible. Somebody can be on stage and you sometimes just kind of think, why is that funny? I'm not saying it from a critical point of view. I'm saying I've been laughing and I'm not altogether sure why, you know?
I have to say, you've got this, Fred, because I remember seeing you. I'm not blowing smoke up your backside here, but when before you were on the TV and the radio, and you did a headline spot again in Edinburgh, and I saw you there, and you were coming out, and you've just summed it up, because you were talking about Scotland getting put out of the Euro 96.
Right.
And what you were saying, if it was written down, you would go, that's not funny.
Aye.
But when you were saying it, the whole room, I was nuts. And it's just that you have that way of that engaging personality and able to take material and put it across. You know?
Well, that's what I'm going to be doing more of.
Good. Yeah. And you're like, well, tell us about the tour. How many dates have you lined up?
There will probably be about 30 by the time it's all done and dusted. Mm-hmm. There'll be mostly weekends, Thursdays, Fridays, Saturdays and Sundays. I'm going to try and keep the radio show going at the same time.
Right.
And then the tour will continue in the spring next year for Scotland. And then, you know, just play it by ear. You know, now that we're sort of 20 years into it, is that you do get the feeling that you've maybe got some longevity.
I would think so. And where do we find out about it online? If we want to
FredMacaulay.com.
Which is your website?
The website, yeah.
And you Twitter and Facebook too?
I Twitter, I tweet, you know, I admire these people that have got 1.5 million followers. I think as we speak today, I've got about 14,000, so happy enough with that.
Absolutely.
Yep. So
that's pretty respectable. So what is it at?
Fred Macaulay. No hiding place. It's just Fred Macaulay at Fred Macaulay.
Well, I wish you the best with the tour, and it's been a real pleasure
to
meet you today. Yeah.
Do you know this? We've both had a smile on our face from the minute we saw each other.
And why not?
It's good to see you again.
And I'll let you go and find a phone box, Superman.
I could change into this.
All the best, bud. See you soon.
Cheers.